Good morning. Thanks for joining us here today. Thanks to Scott Fielding, our Minister of Finance, for joining me here today. Scott, and thanks to you and your team for all your hard work over the last year and always, both at Treasury Board and in the Department of Finance. We've got a great team of people there. Yesterday was a monumental day in Manitoba, I think for many of us, a long-awaited day that gave us a bit of hope for many Manitobans. As the first few hundred doses of the COVID-19 vaccine were administered by the first priority group of healthcare providers in our province. By the end of the day Friday, by the way, we'll have immunized 900 healthcare workers on the front lines of this pandemic. Looking back over the past year, COVID-19 has handed us many new challenges, many greater than ever before. The virus has challenged each of us to become more resilient, more innovative, more determined. It's probably made us more conscious of the importance of our communities, of our services, and of each other to one another in our beautiful province. Our government's number one priority has been and will continue to be protecting our most vulnerable Manitobans and ensuring that our healthcare system is there for all Manitobans when they need it during this pandemic and well after this pandemic as well. Notre priorité numéro un dans cette pandémie est de protéger nos Manitobains les plus vulnérables et de veiller à ce que notre système de santé soit le pour tous les Manitobains quand ils ont besoin. Prior to COVID, your government made a vow to Manitobans to focus on fixing the finances, repairing the services, and rebuilding our economy, and we have kept our word, and we did it with discipline, and we did it with caring. We succeeded the past fiscal year to move from close to a $1 billion deficit when we first came to government to balancing the budget. And that's quite an accomplishment for our finance minister and for his team and for everyone in government, something they deserve to be proud of. Because we did this while maintaining the highest levels of support in Canada on health care, education and social services of any province. And we did this, thank goodness, just in time to face the next big fiscal and public health challenge, COVID-19, probably the biggest challenge in our province's modern history. Throughout the last 5 years, and even more so throughout this pandemic, my government's been led by Manitoba values, by Manitoba discipline, by foresight, by teamwork, and we have been inspired by the character of Manitoba citizens. Manitobans live within their means because they care about today and because they care about tomorrow too. And your government has done the same, and we're going to continue to do the same. We're going to do what Manitobans do. We are going to shop smarter, we're going to invest more wisely, and we're going to focus on protecting those most in need. And we're going to do that by moving more resources to the front line where they are needed. And they are needed there now. Just like Manitobans, your government understands the difference between wants and needs. That's a tough thing to understand, but it's critical to succeeding in protecting your family's own interests and your own financial management at home or in your small business, and most certainly for a government as well. It's critical. The needs over the past 9 months have been, and we believe for some time, are going to continue to be, to protect Manitoba's most vulnerable communities, to protect our healthcare system, to protect our business owners who create jobs and put capital at risk and invest in their communities, and to provide goods and services that Manitobans rely and depend upon. And today, Scott and I are here to provide you with an update on the evolving economic situation in Manitoba as we continue to fight COVID-19 and as we continue to plan for a safer, healthier, and more prosperous future. I'm going to pass it over to Scott now, and our finance minister will provide you with some additional details. Scott, over to you.
Well, thank you, Premier Pallister. And today we're releasing Manitoba's mid-year financial report and economic update. Back in March, when we released our budget, COVID-19 had not yet arrived in Manitoba. Since then, we've had to revise our outlook as we address Manitoba's largest health, financial, and quite frankly, economic challenge really of our lifetime. Since March, we've committed $3.2 billion to address the pandemic. This includes spending to address its impact this year and spending to help recover in future years. Manitoba's spending is estimated as the third highest level amongst provinces on a per capita basis. So again, third highest in Canada on a per capita basis. COVID-19 related health expenditures is approximately $633 million above what we had budgeted in the initial budget. Again, $633 million above what we had budgeted in the budget. That includes over $522 million related to personal protective equipment and supplies. We've negotiated and partnered with the federal government to receive $648 million for our COVID response. And that $648 million accounts for about 20% of the total commitment, which the province is footing about 80%. So again, we very much appreciate the supports with the federal government, but it does represent 20%. The provincial supports are over 80% to provide supports to Manitobans. Our government remains focused on two things: protecting Manitobans first and foremost, and supporting Manitobans and businesses impacted by the deadly pandemic. We've created some of the most generous programs in the country to support those in need, help bridge the gap for businesses impacted by the lockdowns, and invest in the safety of Manitobans of all ages. Since our first quarter report in September, we've announced more than $585 million in new supports, such as the Manitoba Bridge Grant Program, which has already provided supports for close to 8,000 businesses, over $80 million, as well as programs like the Gap Protection Program, where close to 10,000 businesses have been supported. Our business support programs have been broad-based, they've been easy to access, they've been flexible, and quite frankly, they've been based on consultations with local business community to really design to meet the needs of local businesses. We've committed over $185 million of additional investments in education to do things such as hire new teachers and provide supports for students. This year, our expenses are up by more than $1.4 billion, which includes about $1.8 billion of supports for COVID-related supports, again, offset by savings in other areas. We are now forecasting a year-end deficit of over $2 billion, in fact, $2.046 billion over this year, which is an improvement from our first quarter projected of nearly $3 billion, but would still be the highest deficit in Manitoba's history. Revenues are down by $372 million compared to budget because of the economic downturn. This is mainly due to lower taxes and other revenues. In the spring, the Manitoba legislature approved supplement borrowing of $5 billion to ensure that we can address pandemic funding needs. So far, we've been able to successfully access domestic and international markets to meet our borrowing needs, but if it becomes unavailable, we have $800 million in a rainy day fund to guarantee us extra liquidity. And that's important because our government made a focus to replenish the rainy day from about $110 million that it had been deplenished to about $800 million. Manitoba's current economic outlook expects real GDP to grow by 4.6% in 2020, decline by 4.6% in 2020, and rebound in 2021 by 4.1%. The latest private sector forecasts indicate a strong recovery over the next 2 years. We know our economic recovery will be protracted and uneven, but we will continue to invest in our recovery to reinforce our public health response as well as our economic and fiscal resilience. We've invested when and where we need it to ensure supports are in place as we battle COVID-19 and look ahead to the long-term recovery. Thank you, and now I'll turn it back to you, Mr. Premier.
Thank you, Scott, very much. And again, I would say this year has been like no other. It's not one that any of us would hope to repeat, but it has shown Manitoba and Manitobans at their finest in many ways. And your government recognizes the significant personal and professional sacrifices that all Manitobans have made in the face of this pandemic in order to protect themselves, to protect their loved ones, to protect their community. All of us have a role to play in protecting one another. And I want to say a special thank you to all Manitobans who've stepped up to that challenge. Your government will do everything that it can to protect the health and well-being of all Manitobans today and into the future. And that's why we've already committed, as Scott referenced, over $3 billion in supports for Manitobans during this unprecedented time. That's the third highest per capita investment behind only Ontario and Quebec in Canada. Unlike many provinces who experienced the first wave of COVID in the spring and the second wave thereafter in the fall, Manitoba was essentially hit with the first and second waves a few weeks ago at the same time. And that's resulted in a really significant strain on our healthcare system. And so I would say to those who are on the front lines and have faced that challenge, thank you so much for doing that. And to you on the front lines of our education system as well, I want to say thank you for being the adaptable and adaptable leaders and responsible leaders that you are for our children. We've been preparing for these challenges. We came in prepared fiscally by moving to balance and being stronger than we would have been without that effort. We have been preparing to respond with supports that we have developed for our communities, for our vulnerable individuals, and for our small business people when and where they needed it most. For example, in terms of the PPE investments that Scott referenced, it bears repeating, over $500 million of personal protective equipment and purchased by our government, and related materials also for our frontline workers that are so essential to protect them. In the last few months alone, we have announced more than $500 million of additional supports in things like the bridge grant Scott referenced for our small businesses, the Safe Schools Fund, Long-Term Recovery Fund, Caregiver Wage Support Program, Pandemic Staffing Support Benefits, and various other programs as well. Your government will continue to target investments, develop the right programs at the right time to protect Manitobans from COVID-19 and bridge to a safer future for all of us. This last year has not been easy. The next few weeks will not be easy either. But I am confident that if we continue to work together as a team, we can and we will get back to beating COVID-19. And then we can also enjoy all this beautiful province has to offer us. This week's monumental for Manitobans is immunizations for the life-saving COVID vaccine are now underway to protect close to 1,000 healthcare workers on the front line of this pandemic. And for many, this is an exciting and a hopeful time in our province. But I must remind all Manitobans, again, as the stern dad, I guess some say I am, that we are not out of the woods yet. And so I say to all Manitobans, wherever you live in our beautiful province, wherever you work, wherever you invest, wherever you have a family, remember that COVID is sneaky, that COVID is dangerous, that COVID kills. And as it continues to take its toll on far too many Manitobans, remember especially as we approach the holidays, follow the doctor's orders, stay safe, follow the fundamentals. And if you do that, and I know you will, next year is going to be an amazing year to celebrate the triumph that we have made together over COVID. Thank you. I look forward to taking your questions, and Scott does too, of course.
Thank you, Mr. Premier. A reminder to our reporters on the line, you will have one preliminary and one follow-up question this morning. Up first from CTV Winnipeg, Jeff.
Oh, hello, gentlemen. Jeff from CTV Winnipeg. I guess this question might be more for the finance minister. You attribute the improved deficit number, obviously, to federal funding, but there's still about, I think, 250 or close to 300 million. It's down as well. Is it because of what it says on page 4 here in the mid-year review that revenue impact had been overestimated between spring and fall due primarily due to uncertainties in modeling? Is that what you attribute it to? Were revenues not as impacted as you'd anticipated?
Yeah, I would say that we've lost about $1 billion in revenue when you look at personal income tax, corporate taxes, our own source revenue, money that comes in from the Crown corporations that is offset by some of the negotiations we've had with the federal government to provide some supports in the neighborhood of $650 million. So that makes up the revenue change. Jeff, I think that you had mentioned. Again, we've lost $1 billion in revenues. We did pick up some monies that the premiers negotiated with the prime minister that makes up the difference.
Okay, and my second question is, you know, with this projected improvement of the deficit, and yeah, I get it, a lot of it has to do with federal funds. Can you pay it off? Do you have projections that you don't have to, like the throne speech said, take, I guess, another two terms or however long it will be? Can you bump that timeline up?
Well, what I would say is that you always need a plan to get yourself back into balance. That's initially what we did when we first came to office, so with a responsible plan to do it within 8 years. And that was laid out in our throne speech. We're going to have more to say that, during the budget process. But right now, our two priorities is to protect Manitobans and to support businesses that have been impacted and individuals that have been impacted by COVID-19.
From City News, Jonas.
Good afternoon, Minister Fielding, Mr. Premier. An overview idea question for you guys. Now that, you know, vaccines are on the way, there appears to be, you know, somewhat of a harder end date to this. How does that affect how you evaluate spending moving forward over the next couple months? Is there any change, I guess, to your ideal of how to get money out the door now that it looks like there may be an end date on the way?
Go ahead, Scott.
Well, number one, I think just back to the point I just made, our number one, there's two goals that we have as a government to protect Manitobans. We're going to do what it takes. We've invested more than $633 million above what we budgeted in health to protect Manitobans. And we're going to provide some of the most generous supports that, in fact, the third highest supports of all provinces for individuals and businesses. So we want to make sure those supports are in place and people are protected until we're at a point where, you know, we're seeing the numbers go down in terms of the vaccine and we're able to get back to kind of a normal level for the most part. But our government is focused in on those two things and we're going to do what it takes to support Manitobans and businesses and protect Manitobans.
Thank you for that. If you wouldn't mind, Minister Fielding, just walking us through some of the under expenditures so far as we walk through some of this. One that jumps out to me is $55 million under expenditure in education. It says part of that will be reinvested in safe schools. But just some of these under expenditures and just how this money, I guess, works.
Sure. Absolutely. So first of all, right now we're spending about $1.4 billion more than we had budgeted. So I don't want to leave you with the impression that somehow there's under expenditures. That's made up of two things. Number one, as you mentioned, $1.8 billion of additional supports for people in business through COVID types of relief with a number of the programs, Gap, Bridge, Risk Recognition. These are programs that are broad-based and support individuals. It's also made up of $372 million, or just over $370 million in under expenditures. These are things that are money in agriculture. I think it's $22 million for less money that's used for the MAST trust. There's things that were deferred or delayed because some things to do with COVID. But there's also things like the education system, for instance. Although there's under expenditure, there was monies that was saved in the education system. It has been reinvested and more. So we've invested $185 million in the education system. That's made up of the $48 million in savings that we initially had from the education system that's been given back to the divisions, as well as about $79 or $69 million in a per pupil basis, as well as other additional supports for remote learning. That's as well, and other $39 million in supports for divisions. So the under expenditures have been reinvested for the most part, and we are anticipating, in fact, we're projecting $1.4 billion of additional spending at the end of the day.
From the Winnipeg Free Press, Carol.
Hi there. Just going back to that, so how much of the $3.2 billion budgeted has already been spent, and is there any chance you'd consider directing some of the unspent pandemic response money to small businesses that are still hurting and expecting they may not be able to open their doors again?
Carol, thanks for that. We have the most generous programs outside per capita, outside of some programs in PEI in Canada now. And we're in the midst of discussing a strategy with the Manitoba Chamber of Commerce helping us and Economic Development Winnipeg helping us on an additional $50 million allocation of supports. But I will say this, I think that what the vast majority of our small business people would like is that we beat COVID together so they can get back to doing what they do best, which is providing goods and services to Manitobans. They'd much prefer us to be able to reopen safely as soon as possible, and so we're continuing to make that our number one priority, to focus on getting that COVID number and those COVID numbers down to save lives, and also, as a consequence, to help our small business community bounce back as soon as they can.
Mr. Fielding, there have been multiple reports of residential tenants facing increases that are far above the guidelines, that are inexplicable, and renters are trying to find out, you know, how they can be justified. Is this something that's a concern that you're looking into? Is it something that you plan to address, just because renters are in a hard place, because a lot of them are suffering because of the economic impact of the pandemic as well?
Well, a few things. Number one, we are one of the first provinces to introduce rent freeze as well as eviction moratorium. In fact, we lasted longer than all other provinces, or many other provinces like Alberta and Saskatchewan and Ontario with it. We have provided broad-based supports, and I'll give you some examples. The risk recognition program, in it itself, supported about 79,000 people that are in the workforce. That's about 12% of our workforce. The caregiver support, again, thousands of Manitobans were supported by this. Seniors that are in fixed income, we provided support for seniors, about $45 million. 236,000 seniors got supported. So we have provided, as the Premier mentioned, the third highest supports to businesses and individuals of all Manitobans. And in terms of the rent and evictions, we had the longest moratorium, I would suggest, of all the country.
Taxes on estates, taxes on tax preparation, taxes, PST on your home insurance or your business insurance, and rebates from MPI are helpful as well. So we put hundreds of millions of dollars on the kitchen tables of Manitoba families, including an emphasis on our lower income families.
From Global, Malika.
Hi, this question is for Premier Pallister. This is actually just touching on something you said on an earlier press conference, talking about Pegwis First Nation, and wanting to know if you've heard back from the Prime Minister's office about the correspondence that you sent to hopefully get to...
Yeah, thanks, Malika. Again, we're all in this together. COVID doesn't discriminate, neither should we. And our provincial health rules are designed to be followed by all, not by some. And so we need to make sure that we work together on this. And I would mention, and I have great respect for Chief Hudson, so I don't want this to be misconstrued, but over 60% of the members of the Pegwis First Nation that he's inviting home for Christmas don't live at Pegwis. They live in Winnipeg and other communities around the province. And when they travel, COVID potentially travels with them. I respect, and I have sent a letter some weeks ago to all of our chiefs across the province congratulating them and encouraging them in their efforts to fight COVID. And I sent that because I was hearing that some of them were being criticized because the numbers are coming up. Overall, the numbers are coming up in many of our Indigenous communities, and that is a scary thing, but it's not for a lack of effort by the chiefs. And Pegwis and the council and chief there have done a very good job. So this is not to dispute the work that chiefs have put in, whether they're in the midst of a battle with COVID right now or they are temporarily succeeding. We all know that COVID is too sneaky to give up on. And you don't let your guard down, and that's what the chief is proposing to do, and I don't agree. So I don't appreciate the federal Minister Miller, Indigenous Minister Miller, saying that provincial health rules don't apply on reserves, because they most certainly do, and they must, because we're all in this together. We live together here in Manitoba. This is not a fully integrated province, but it is largely an integrated province where our neighbors might be Indigenous or Métis. And so saying there are separate rules for everybody is not helpful. And no, I have not heard back from the Prime Minister, but I would like to hear back quickly, and I would like him to give clarity to this, because this is not a good idea. It is a really, really bad idea.
Thank you, Premier. And my follow-up question is for you as well. We've been hearing anecdotally about people booking, Manitobans booking holidays in Kenora for this break, and seeing more and more Manitobans there doing some shopping, What is your thoughts on this? What do you want to tell Manitobans about traveling at this point?
Well, Dr. Rusin will remind everybody in about an hour of exactly what he thinks, and I will just repeat that they need to follow the doctor's orders. Manitobans need to understand when they travel, COVID can go with them, and we have to all be diligent here. It's going to mean short-term pain, but it's saving lives. And we're seeing now, versus other provinces, some progress, but it's not any indication that we're out of the woods, and let's not misconstrue it. I mean, yes, our weekly numbers are down by 16%, but that's not a victory lap thing. You know, Alberta, some would say, didn't put in its restrictions soon enough. Others are critical of the Premier in Ontario, others critical of the Premiers in Quebec for saying they didn't put the restrictions in that Manitoba put in early enough. And, you know, you're seeing numbers up 16% in Ontario week over week, up 17.9% in Quebec, 24% increase in Alberta. Okay. Saying that and saying we're down 16% is not a reason for us to let our guard down. It's the opposite. You know, we are in a dangerous time right now. We're getting into the holiday season. People are people. You want to get together. I know that. So do I. But we're not going to do it this year. We're not going to do it because it'll save lives and we can keep COVID down. And that's the goal here. So let's work together so we can all be together next year. Make sure we don't do anything that would cause additional dangers and risks to the people of our province and other provinces.
From the Brandon Sun, Colin.
Good morning. I remember back in March, there had been some concern that the rainy day fund might be used up due to the province's COVID response. With it being at $800 million at the end of the year. I was wondering if you could explain how you were able to keep it so built up.
I can take that one, I guess. I think it's interesting how, I have to say, the opposition wouldn't have had a rainy day fund, but they're sure quick to tell us to spend this one right now. You know, the idea of having an emergency fund in your own personal financial plan is so that you can have it available as a cushion, but it also helps you in order to have security against future risks. I expect Scott will very likely, as the COVID continues, have to use some of that rainy day fund money. But in the last year, it's helped Scott to borrow at better rates because we've shown that we had the ability to manage our finances just as you might be able to get a better rate on your mortgage if you had an emergency fund than if you didn't. And so we've been actually able to get more money, more cheaply, to use for our vulnerable, protecting our most vulnerable people as a result of having that rainy day fund. The NDP wouldn't have had one, and they'd want us to spend this one right now, but what if we have a flood next spring? What if we have a fire? And what if we need more programs for small business or more programs for our vulnerable citizens? And I think we may. So that's why that rainy day fund is there. It's there to protect us, but it's not there to be spent willy-nilly because then we won't have a rainy day fund later, and then we'll have to go back and borrow at higher rates, and that would be a loss to the people of Manitoba.
Just to clarify, you were able to borrow money at a cheaper rate instead of spending money from the rainy day fund?
Exactly. By the presence of an emergency fund, if you go to your banker and tell him you haven't got a red cent, you're going to pay more to borrow money than if you tell him you've got some savings. That's how simple it is. So that's the benefit that we've had of forward thinking and planning. We came in with virtually no rainy day fund, depleted in sunny days by the previous government, and a billion-dollar deficit, very close to $1 billion deficit. We were able to whittle away at that deficit, get it to balance, and restore a rainy day fund. Thank goodness, because that positions us to be much stronger responders in the face of COVID-19 than we would have been otherwise.
From CJOB, Clay.
Yeah, good morning, gentlemen. Mr. Fielding, my question very similar to Jeff Keel's, but again, if you could just explain how the deficit projection has been downgraded. What factors came into play here?
Okay, absolutely. So number one, in terms of revenues, we've lost about $1 billion in revenues, and that's made up of personal income taxes around $250 million, corporate income taxes about $141 million, PST revenues that we bring in, we're down by about $44 million. We've lost money on things like our crown corporations, things like the casinos, for instance, that have been shut down. You lose about $40 million a month every time you do that. So we're down by about $212 million that are there. We are up in some of the other crowns. So that all totaled, it's about $1 billion in revenues that we have lost. Where we have done some pickup is in terms of the supports from the federal government because of the negotiations that the premiers did on the safe restart agreement. So we picked up about $648 million in revenues. We did identify that in the Q1, but we didn't put it in as revenue because we actually hadn't received it. So we're only down about $372 million in terms of our revenues. In terms of expenditures, we anticipate expending about $1.4 billion more than we had budgeted. It's made up of two things. Number one, $1.8 billion of supports for COVID-related reliefs. And there's been some under expenditures in other areas, $372 million to make up about $1.4 billion difference. So that kind of outlines the revenues and expenditures. But what I do want to narrow into you is we're tracking for a $2 billion deficit. That is the highest deficit that we're going to run. Probably, in fact, it is in Manitoba's history. And that's because of the supports, the $3.2 billion overall that we've given towards supports for individuals and businesses. We've been investing money to support businesses and individuals throughout this pandemic.
Thank you. My next follow-up is to the Premier. Premier Pallister saw that earlier this week, actually, I think it was yesterday, Ontario health officials are very worried there's going to be another surge in COVID-19 cases after the holidays. And I know you've said it a million times, sir, but are you worried that another surge could happen in Manitoba after the holidays? I'm not speaking of people traveling into Kenora. I'm talking about people going from Charleswood over to Transcona to spend Christmas Day and have a turkey dinner.
Yeah, thanks, Clay, for that. I'm going to say it a million and one times. This is a test for all Manitobans. This next 2-3 weeks is going to be really hard, and it's a test of our mettle. It's a test of our willpower. It's a test of our willingness to sacrifice short-term for long-term good. We are starting to plateau on our numbers. We need them down. And Manitobans can bring them down by their decisions over the next few weeks. So I'm inviting Manitobans to celebrate Christmas this year differently and really consider the blessings we have of each other and make sure that we protect each other now, because we're precious people to one another and we know that better now than we ever have. So I just urge Manitobans to do the right thing now. Listen to the doctor's orders. Stick to your guns. Be determined. Be disciplined. Beat COVID back. We can do this, and we can do it together.
From the Winnipeg Sun, Josh.
Good afternoon, Minister and Premier. Going back to the early days of the pandemic, I guess I have a PPE question. PPE listed, is that the actual total spent to this point on PPE, or is that the forecasted amount? Is far less than the predicted almost $1 billion in PPE expenditures from early in the pandemic. Why through 9 months of this are we barely at half that projection? And especially with the almost daily stories about the need for more PPE, whether it's in seniors' homes or for other frontline workers, could you explain the PPE costs a little bit more, why we're kind of at where we're at, where we're hearing the demand for so much more?
Yeah, so we're spending about $633 million above what we budgeted in healthcare. That is a mass sum of money. That's made up, again, over $500 million of things like PPE and testing. In fact, if you look at PPE or you look at things like testing and contact tracing, I believe we're spending about $180 million on that alone. So again, it's made up over $500 million of PPE and PPE-related things with testing and over $100 million of supports. This is staffing supports during the pandemic for healthcare officials.
And Josh, just elaborate quickly. Massive kudos go out to Manitoba small businesses that stepped up. We organized a partnership program to reach out and ask Manitobans if they could retool some of their businesses to help us to produce PPE right here in Manitoba. And this is truly an example of a made in Manitoba solution that we were able to get more PPE produced right in Manitoba. to address our needs. And now we have reserves available in virtually every category of PPE that are going to be available and will strengthen our position going forward. Hopefully, Dr. Theresa Tam is wrong. Hopefully, her projections that our case numbers in Canada are going to double by the end of the year are wrong. But we're preparing for worse situations, and we have to be ahead of this thing and not chasing it.
Okay. excuse me. My follow-up question is, considering there was that expected shortfall of $2.9 billion after the first quarter, I know you've kind of broken down how we're now at about $2 billion, but is this potential extra wiggle room if COVID-19 drags on quite a bit more, like you talked about the expected surge after Christmas, is extra wiggle room to handle more expenses and shortfalls later in the fiscal year, or are you banking on more transfers coming from the federal government later to help handle some of these forecasted expenses and shortfalls?
Yeah, there's, I don't know if you call it wiggle room, if that's accurate, but there's room. Obviously, we budgeted for larger expenditures. We may need to have that money available in the coming quarter. A lot depends on how Manitobans respond. Quite frankly, a lot depends on that. How quickly we can reopen our economy is in the hands of Manitobans. How many people are going to be in hospitals is in the hands of Manitobans. How many people need to go into an intensive care unit is in the hands of Manitobans. We're doing our absolute best to get the message out in every way we can, and we're ready to partner and we're ready to support. And yes, the federal government should be a partner. It's a national emergency, for heaven's sakes. Of course the federal government should be partnering, and is, and should be congratulated on that. With provinces and territories. So, yeah, we're anticipating, of course, those partnerships with the feds will continue. And we're anticipating also that there may well be more needs for supports, and we're ready to step up and provide those.
From CBC Radio Canada, Julien.
Good morning. My question is relating to the vaccines that we're starting to receive. Do we have a forecast of the cost of immunization in the province in the next month?
Julien, encore, s'il vous plaît.
I was just wondering if we do have a forecast for the cost of immunization in the province since we received the vaccines.
A forecast? I'm sorry, Julien, I didn't hear you. Do we have a forecast for, and then I missed the rest?
For the cost of immunization in the province.
Okay. Scott, do you have an idea?
We do. We got a ballpark estimate. It's north of $10 million for sure.
Okay. And my follow-up question is regarding the tax revenue. Do we know which industry we lost the most tax revenue?
Which industries have been impacted? The industries that have been impacted the most are things like accommodation, travel, obviously restaurants. These are things that have been impacted quite a bit. There has been some industries that have done better, things like construction, science, technological, agriculture has done, more to do with, what's coming in the bin more than anything else. But for the most part, some have talked about a K-shaped recovery, pretty similar to other provinces. But we all know the industries really that have been impacted the most, and we want to tailor our supports to those to make sure they get across when we get to a normal level after COVID.
From CBC Manitoba, Bart.
Hi, first one's for Minister Fielding. Minister, what makes you folks confident that you're going to get 4% GDP rebound in the coming year?
Well, we're as confident as the bond rating agencies and the forecasting agencies that we rely on to develop our modeling. So we really depend on some of the forecasting agencies that put it. And that's really how we develop our forecasts.
Yeah, I was hoping for factors, but okay. Also, what is the province doing to mitigate the uneven effects of what they call the K-shaped recovery?
Well, I would suggest that our investments, $3.2 billion investments and supports for businesses and individuals, is the third highest in Canada. is something that's there. I think we've designed a lot of programs that are broad-based, a lot of programs that are really based on consultation with industry groups, things that are flexible, and getting the money in your hands quickly, like the Bridge and the Gap program, for instance. Once you're approved, you got the money in your bank account within 48 hours, and that's really important to businesses. So I think it's really investing in the specific industries and listening to industries, and for the most part, you know, I think we've gotten it right. We've also shown some flexibility to make some needed changes to programs that's been there, so we're proud of that.
I think that's a great question, Bartley, and I would just add to Scott's comments and say mental health supports, paid sick leave, addictions funding, additional municipal supports, infrastructure investments, additional infrastructure investments, funding for homeless, vulnerable folks that way, reductions in tax that affect and benefit disproportionately those who are in the lower income scale. These are all measures we've taken. In addition to the global broader efforts, we've also targeted our efforts to assist those most in need, and many, many other measures as well. Obviously, the rent deferrals Scott alluded to earlier, interest tax deferrals, rebates for MPI, rebates for workers' comp programs. Putting money out there, more on the kitchen table, to help Manitoba families, in particular those most vulnerable, seniors benefits. These are all programs that we've launched. It's been a historic year for new programs, but those programs have been needed during this historic pandemic.
From the Canadian Press, Steve.
Oh, hi there. Just wondering, the projections for spending on business and personal supports, is that still based on 100% subscription rate? Because some of these programs have been undersubscribed. Is it based on a 100% take-up? And can you update us on what some of that uptake is?
Yeah, I can generally tell you that every one of these programs is almost without precedent. I can tell you that, as in every other jurisdiction, uptake may vary from budgeted number, and I can tell you that our uptake is rising as we speak, and that our budgeted amount we expect to use fully in the areas like business supports, for example, where it's climbing every day now, and we're none of us happy that it's needed. Bridge financing is needed, though, because folks aren't able to operate as fully as they'd like in many cases. These supports will continue, and we're also looking to allocate, with the guidance of our business advisors, we're also looking to allocate additional funds in the tens of millions. So we anticipate, as we get through the year, we're well over half. I haven't got a daily number. Do you have, Scott, one right now?
The only thing that I would mention to the Premier's comments is we showed some flexibility. So an example of that is the GAP program. Right. So, for instance, we had allocated about $120 million. We ended up spending $68 million. We took the existing dollars that were there, right, and we moved it into other programs like the Bridge support programs, and same thing, the wage subsidy. So we put additional dollars where it's needed. We've showed some flexibility to move things around. And, you know, I think there will be some additional programming that you're going to see. Our hope is that we get out of this pandemic sooner rather than later. My sense is that we're going to have to revisit this, and we're always going to work with the business community. But to your point of, you know, we're not going to apologize for providing a lot of supports for Manitobans. And if there's ability to change programs, make it more effective, we've done that, or repurposing dollars to other programs, that's something that we will continue to do.
Okay, and back in the spring when this started hitting us in the first wave, the government told us that the rainy day fund would be used up probably by June, and the deficit could have run as high as $5 billion. Now both those things have turned out to be much less dire than expected. So are you going to open up the kitty a little more and come up with new programs? Or are you going to try to keep the deficit to a still record high, $2 billion?
Well, first of all, we could have spent the rainy day fund first, Steve, but we chose not to, so that it would continue to assist us in negotiating better with our borrowing agencies. We've had to borrow a tremendous amount. And I wouldn't jump the gun and be too premature on deficits. What we're projecting is for this year end, but COVID could last a lot longer than we thought. Initially, a lot of the projections, and not just in Manitoba but elsewhere, we're thinking this was going to be a V situation where the COVID would impact everybody and then we get out of it sooner. Now we're looking at an L or some other model, some other letter you might choose to use. So I think it's a question of spreading out the deficit probably over a longer period rather than just in one fiscal. So we put out our projections to the best of our ability, remembering there's no playbook, and we're going to continue to do that and share those projections with Manitobans, just as our finance minister has done so well today. I'll just close by saying thanks to everybody. There's a diversity of views on almost every issue, and I expect that today there'll be people who say we're not spending enough, and there'll be other people who say that we're spending too much. But I want as much as I appreciate all these different perspectives, I want to say to Manitobans, we are striving for balance. And our criticisms can be leveled and have been, and that's okay, because we're all stressed and we all know that we have an opinion, and that's good. But I would remind people, you know, school closures, some said too late, some said too soon. Seniors benefits, too little, too much. Job programs, too few, too many, some said. Border restrictions, too soft, too hard. Enforcement fines, too high, too low. Good. Every decision we make is open to criticism. The finance minister, my ministerial colleagues, our government are ready to take those criticisms, but I want to share with Manitobans, we totally accept that because mental health supports, paid sick leave, infrastructure supports, municipal government supports, addictions funding, homeless funding, all of these things, and many others can be criticized, but understand this. We inherited a province when we came into government that was first in per capita debt in the country, and we have maintained the position with our government of being first in the country in investing in health, education, and social services. Number one, nobody has passed us, and we've done that while taking this province away from massive deficits and moving to balance. We've cleaned the situation up as best we could while maintaining a focus on supporting our most vulnerable people. And we always do our absolute best in every respect to strive for the balance that Manitobans know is necessary in their own lives, because that's the kind of people who inspire us. So I say to Manitobans, I appreciate the advice, and we listen to the advice. And we've been criticized by some saying we listen too much or not enough. But the fact remains, we are going to continue to listen, and we're going to continue to act on the advice we hear. So I thank everybody for your interest in this, and I think today is more good news than bad, but as we move forward, the good news that will come in the future will largely be in our hands. Keep safe. Thank you.
Thank you.